This is John from Polymath Producer, and at Polymath Producer, we analyze the great producers of all time, figure out what they do in their tracks, why they do it, and ultimately how they think. And in this episode, we're looking at Maroon 5 Sugar. Okay, now this was produced by Ammo and Circuit, who are two of the biggest producers of the 2010s. They've done many, many number one hits between them. So we're going to look at how they have produced this track. And I think the interesting thing that we look at in this track is Maroon 5 is a band. So they play organic instruments. They play traditional guitar sounds, bass sounds, drum sounds. They've got a band setup. But in this track in particular, they've layered that band setup, that traditional band setup, with more of a modern production style using samples and synths. Okay, and we're going to actually analyze that and discover how they've done that. So how they've made a traditional band setup sound more modern. Okay, that's really the main thing we want to take away from this. So we're going to see how they've actually done that in this track today. So to start with, I'm going to start with the core rhythm because this one has a very prominent core rhythm. The kick and snare are both sample based to start with. We're going to look at the sample based material. And if you notice, the snare is a consistent intensity. It's sample based, very consistent intensity. And the kick is also very consistent intensity as well, in terms of like how hard it hits. It also sounds like it's almost layered by a bit of a vinyl crackle as well. But those are the sample based kick and snares. So that is emphasizing the core rhythm of the track. And that plays consistent through the whole track. So those are the core rhythm of the track, the main rhythm that plays throughout the entire track. The bass flows with that. Now, this is a real bass guitar. Now, you can really tell that this is real, because they've got, like, you can hear literally the fingers scraping on the string. So I doubt that this is a contact bass. You know, it's very hard to tell these days because those kind of contact basses are getting so realistic. Like in the Ian Kirkpatrick one we looked at the other day, I really thought that was a real bass when I first heard the song, but this one is actually a real bass, I believe. And I think that is because they have that real band set up. So this isn't just a producer coming in and doing their thing like Ian Kirkpatrick did with the Dua Lipa one. This one is more a band playing. So they've actually got a real bass player, skilled bass player, doing his thing on a real bass. Now this bass is outlining the core rhythm of the track. Everything flows with this. These are the guitars, as you can notice, flowing with it as one. So the guitars are actually the core harmonic rhythmic driver in this track, which is the main harmonic accompaniment material, usually mid-level, that flows with the bass and with the kick and snare. So this makes up the core rhythm of the track. And they've got very small reverse intos for some of the chords, just for rhythmic groove. Stylistically, the bass also has like slaps and sort of slides and things just to make it a bit more funky, because this is like a disco funky kind of pop track. So they've really humanized it. Now, the cool thing about this is that those sample-based drums play through the whole thing, but this drum kit actually plays throughout the whole thing as well. And this is a real drum kit. So this is what I was talking about at the start, where like the cool thing about this track is it shows you how to produce a modern sound for a band setup by making the band set like layered with samples and things like that. So this is the real drum kit. So if you can notice, it's a kick, it's a snare, There's a hat there as well. The hats come a bit in the chorus here. Crash, a lot more hats. But they clearly recorded a real drum player with this. So Maroon 5 obviously is a band. So they've got a real bass player, real guitarist. They've got a real drum player playing this section. And then the producers have actually layered these samples over the top of this. So now it's all just thicker. So if there's one thing you want to take away from this, is if you are producing for a band or you want that live band feel, then a way to make it sound more thicker in terms of like the sound, and if you want it to sound more modern and I guess recent sounding, then layering the real drum kit with samples can make it sound bigger. Okay, so that's the main principle that I want you to take away from this analysis. That is the main rhythm of the song right there. And that basically happens throughout the whole track. This is by itself. With samples, without, with. So it really makes the difference there. The guitars in this start off with just the mid-level harmonic driver that we talked about earlier. So slight reverse into there if you heard that. Interesting effects on it as well. Interesting guitar amp. Now that's in the verse. When it gets to the chorus, they actually add another one. So another guitar playing, the same rhythm, but different chords, a bit higher chords, and it's panned slightly to the left. So they're doubling. They're playing the same rhythm, but the one on the left is accenting certain parts of that chord rhythm. And then when it comes to the second half of the chorus, so the part where they sing Show Me Good Lovin', I believe. Yeah. That's when they start to introduce more subtle energetic layers. So a lot of these world-class producers, they add subtle layers using what they already have. So the audience wouldn't even realize that this is happening, but these guitars are opening up. Like, have a listen. First half of the chorus, they have the main rhythmic driver that we heard earlier in the verse, one on the left, a bit higher, and then this one comes in to the right. Emphasizes the chord changes and does a slight arpeggio down as well. And it's the same range as the one that's panned left, so they've panned it slightly right, I think. And I think that's why it works. They've got the mid-level driver that's happening an octave lower than those two. Or a different inversion. Now, in verse two, they go back to just the mid-level and the one that's higher to the left. Now, in second chorus, they've got an entrance hit on every chord change. So it's like a new big strum on each chord change. Entrance hit. A bit higher, weird effects on it as well. Now they've added another one in, about the same range. It's emphasizing even further. So, as you can notice there, there's four different guitar parts that are playing all simultaneously as the energy builds. And the audience wouldn't even know what's happening. So in the verse, this is just with the rhythmic driver in the middle. Kind of subtle, emphasizes the rhythm. In the chorus, it's higher, so it stands out more. The lower sounding parts are more back, and then as it gets higher, the higher chords start to stand out in the chorus. Second half of the chorus. You can't really hear the parts that come in the second half of the chorus, but then in the second chorus, very subtle, but it is a lot more dense in terms of its texture, because they've got those four layers happening now. Now let's have a look what happens in the last chorus, because that gets even more dense. So they've got three layers, I think, at the moment, or four. And that's the first half of the chorus. Now they add a counter-rhythmic funk guitar, counter-rhythm, on the offbeat. Now, the purpose of that is because when you add counter-rhythms, it actually creates conflict with the core rhythm. And if it's healthy conflict, then it creates energetic movement. So they've reserved the counter-rhythmic guitar for the finale of the track, which is something that's very common in a lot of the tracks in the 2010s that we've analyzed so far, is that they reserve counter rhythms and an extra, I guess, both melodic and percussive material for the finale to differentiate it from the rest. So to create more chaos. And when you create the controlled chaos with those counter rhythms, it can sound a lot more bigger in comparison to the other choruses. And that's exactly what we're hearing here. So they've got that funk guitar playing on the offbeat, really, of the other guitars. And to top it off, they've got a little melodic fill there, which I just did then with the guitar. So all up, there's like, it's like five or six or seven different guitar parts that are all layered. The main ones being the mid-level one, the one pan to the left, and the one that plays the entrance chords that is slightly pan to the right. Those are the main ones, but then there's the other ones as well that are in there. So as you can notice, there's multiple guitars in this. And from what I've read, multiple guitar players actually came on this. So the key principle you want to take away from this is that guitars, if you want to repurpose just the instrument of the guitar and make your track energetically wider as the track progresses, then you can do that by inverting chords in terms of like creating inversions. So if you've got a chord that's a lower octave, you can do inversions of chords to make them sound higher but play the same rhythm. So it kind of opens the spectrum up a bit, the frequency spectrum. And you can also use counter rhythms to create healthy conflict and energetic movement in the finales. And you can also use entrance chords for every chord change to kind of emphasize that first beat. Really, you can do this with any instrument. Like, you could even do that with a piano if you wanted to. Like, if the piano is the main rhythmic harmonic driver, you could also layer that with like other parts, other piano parts and stuff like that. So it doesn't really matter what instrument it is, it's more the principle behind it. Like, this is how you do energetic layering over time. Next up, we have the piano. Now, the piano here really just plays the chord changes and emphasizes beat one, which we've seen in a lot of tracks. Emphasis of beat one is very common, especially on chord changes. Emphasis on chord changes, really. But beat one specifically. And this, see, just emphasizes that beat change on the core harmonic rhythmic driver of the guitar. And the keys pretty much play the same thing throughout the whole thing. Kind of sounds like there's slight reverses into the chords as well, like on some of them. Bit of effects there, effects driven. And that's really the role of the keys. And they come in on the second chorus and then they play for the finale as well. So it's really there just to add that energetic layer on top of what we already have. So as the track progresses, they've just added that in. It's very subtle. People probably wouldn't even know it's there, but it's there to fill out the track even further for those to energetically build the track. Now, the only other harmonic material that they have are these synth sections. And this plays throughout the entire track. Really what it is it's an entrance hit on beat one for every chord change with a sustained pad. And if you notice, this actually plays first in the entire track. So it's the main thing that kind of sits underneath the track at all times. It doesn't stop for the whole track, it continues. Now, if you heard this track without that, it makes all the difference. It's almost more funky without it. But with it, it glues everything together. The way that I view pads is they're really like glue. Like they glue the rhythms and the other parts together in the background. So that's really its role there, I think, is that it's kind of like that glue. Now in the chorus, they start to do very subtle energetic development, like we've seen with a lot of the other instruments. So they start to add a higher end synth, as you can hear. And then in the second half of the chorus, Show Me Good Lovin', they add an even higher synth, sustained, over the top. Very similar principle to what we've seen in a lot of these 2010s tracks, where they use subtle energetic development over time, especially in choruses, adding more octave layers. So same instruments or similar instruments in terms of like what they are, like synths, like in this example it's synths, and then they're using different octaves, but similar rhythms to kind of build that energetic intensity over time. So that's exactly what they've done there. Second verse remains the same, but in the second chorus, they introduce the high level synth straight away in the second chorus, and then they start to do melodic motive over the top, so it actually does a counter melody over the top in the second half. Have a listen. Secondary going higher, so a little bit of a counter melody there with the vocal. But you probably wouldn't even be able to really hear this, really, like when you listen to the track with everything. You can't even really hear the synths. Like they're kind of just in the background and they're kind of very subtle. So, but without them, it makes all the difference. That's without it. With them. Yeah. Very cool stuff. In the bridge, they filtered off everything, built it up. In the finale, they've added even more layers and textures in the synth section. So like they've got extra entrance blasts on beat one and chord changes. That was cool. They've actually doubled the vocal there with a synth as well. So bit of a counter melody. Okay. Repurposing principle at play. They're repurposing melodies and they're doubling melodies using advanced layering techniques. So very cool stuff in the synths, and all of that is really quite subtle. Again, I think multiple people had their go at synths. They had multiple people working on this song, the band, they had multiple producers, they had multiple songwriters, and all of them had their go at playing the synths and the guitars and all that stuff to kind of figure out the perfect combinations of what to do in this track. So I thought that was pretty cool. Multiple minds coming together and then polishing this track off like that. Now, the only other instruments that are here are percussion-based instruments that I believe are probably samples, and then they're layering that with the real drum kit who had the real hats and all that stuff. So these are the percussion elements, but I think they're sampled. They appear to be quite consistent. They've got the cowbell coming in on chorus two, so they start to progress the energy, adding more percussive elements over time, which we've seen in other tracks, is a clear energetic move. Build energy over time by adding extra percussion elements. And then in the last chorus, they've actually got a sample-based version, I think, of the drum kit itself. Have a listen. It's quite light though, and in the background, and they've cut off the low end completely. Start to have a bit of counter rhythm right there in the tambourine. So as you can notice, they're adding more and more percussive layers as the track moves into it towards its finale. So this is the finale right here. This is the most chaos that the percussion has been for the whole track. That's layered with this drum kit. The drum kit plays all the fills, very humanized. And that's basically what the percussion does for the track. Now, the only effects in this, there's actually barely any effects, which is quite unusual for a 2010 song. But because they're a band though, they didn't want to do over the top effects that make them sound too electronic. The only effect they really have is this one that comes in the... And that comes at the end, that just when the bridge starts. And that is really just like a really over-the-top reverb guitar hit, I believe. And then the only other effect they have is a vinyl crackle in the background, which we've noticed in a few other tracks. Vinyl crackle, really just to make it fill out like a little bit of subtle space. I don't even know if you can hear that, but that's vinyl crackle right there. And that happens through the whole track, there's vinyl crackle. That's basically all the instrument elements here. Let's play the instrument section together and see what it all sounds like. So you've got vinyl crackle, you've got the synth pad thing playing with the entrance hits. You've got the sampled kick and snare, you've got the drum kit underneath as well, layered with that. You've got the core harmonic rhythmic driver in the guitar. There's no bass playing at this point. Bass comes in, enters in a different octave down the bottom. They start to add a bit of hats over the top with the drums. Into the chorus. Extra guitars higher up. Higher level synths. Energy's getting wider in terms of frequency spectrum. Now, extra percussion comes in. Higher level synths start to come in. Extra guitars come in. Very subtle. Pull it back a bit. Take off a lot of the high-end frequencies. So that stays about the same for the second verse. Now, second chorus, even more energetic development. More percussion, more higher end frequencies earlier on. Way higher frequency melodic material. Now let's move to the very finale. Double time percussion in the second half, more chaos. Fills in the real drums, humanized. Now we've got counter rhythm guitars, counter rhythm percussion, more energy. More synth layers, really starting to come out in the foreground now. So as you can notice, it's really the subtle energetic development using what they already have. So they've kind of repurposed the guitar, they've repurposed the synths, and they've repurposed the percussion in ways where it just builds energetic intensity over time. Last thing we're gonna look at in this track are the vocals, and we're gonna start with the background. I wanna be needing your love, I just wanna be deep in your love, and it's killing me when you're away. So basically what they've done here is they're doubling the lead vocal with vocals to the left, vocals to the right, so just a double of the lead, and then they've got an octave lower as well, which is very common in a lot of tracks post 2010. This seems to be a very common thing where they add that extra octave below or above sometimes, or both, and also the left and right. So with the lead vocal, it sounds like this. I just wanna be deep in your love, and it's killing me when you're away. Baby, 'cause I really don't care where you are. And the octave lower really just emphasizes on certain phrases as well. But really the purpose of that is just to open up the vocal, make it a bit more thicker as the track energetically progresses. I just wanna be there where you are, and I gotta get one little taste. Your sugar, yes please. Same principle in here as well. Put it down on me. I'm right here. They've got those doubles and the one, the octave lower as well for the whole track. But as the track progresses energetically, so in chorus two and the last chorus, they start to add harmonies in there as well. So it's the same stack, same vocal stack, but just with harmonies this time. I'm gonna be needing your love. I just wanna be deep in your love. And it's killing me when you're away. So they've reserved harmonies for more energetic intensity in the latter sections. Yes, please. Won't you come and put it down on me? So introduce harmonies now. I'm right here. Which is another very subtle energetic technique that you can use to develop the energy in your second and last chorus or over time. But again, these aren't rules, because if you looked at Chandelier, or was it Cheap Thrills? No, it was Cheap Thrills, I think. The vocal in that had harmonies immediately, like on the start of the track. So there are no rules here, but usually like 80% of the time from what we've gathered, the harmonies usually start in like the second chorus or the second verse and then continue on from that point on. It really depends on the song at hand. That's why if you understand the principles, if you understand the fundamentals, you know when to use it at the appropriate time, because you've seen it used so many times, and then when you're doing your own track, you kind of just sense when it needs to happen. You just have this intuition. Need a little sweetness. A lot of harmonies in the finale. Yes, please. Now, there's other background vocals here as well, which is interesting. They actually do haze on the entrance hits of the pre-chorus. Hey, 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 hey. Hey. Me when you're away. Oh, hey, hey. Very subtle, but hey. It emphasizes that beat one, which you've seen in a lot of tracks in the 2010s. Yes, now, these. Very similar line to the other background vocals, but these are different people that are singing this, I think. So with the different people, that adds more texture. So to your pack vocals, if you have access to other people, it's very wise to have them sing it as well, so that it sounds a lot thicker, because the textures are all different, which I've done here. So that combined with the other background vocals, which I believe is just the lead singer of Maroon 5, then they sound a lot thicker. Have a listen. I'm right here, this is all together. 'Cause I need little love. Yeah, you show me good loving, make it all right. Need a little. Now those background vocals are really just emphasizing the lead melody, so those are what the other people are doing. They're not doing the harmonies, only the lead singer is. Okay, so in the bridge section, the background vocals do a cool little vocal pad thing that's also rhythmic. Filtered off, and then gets filtered up as the thing progresses, which follows with the synths as well. They're getting filtered up as well. Almost like a bit of a soul influence there. So they're cross-pollinating genres, which is cool. Now, what I love about this is that they use, we've seen it in a lot of other tracks, where they have parts that are played individually as the track is progressing, and then in the finale, they stack those parts and combine them together like Lego building blocks, only for the finale, which I've done here, which I thought is really cool. They've got that sustained vocal pad thing with the other background vocals. Right on the finale. So cool. So, and that those background vocals really act as like almost like a counter rhythm as well, because they're doing these like pad things, and it's almost like glue as well. So it's very cool that they've done that. Like they've combined what they've done earlier into the finale as one. With the ad-libs, really, he just emphasizes certain words in his own way. But the ad-libs are very prominent in the final chorus because he actually does a lot of acrobatic sort of vocal technique. The bomb, that's my sugar. Yes, please. Won't you come and put it down on me? Right here. Bit of call and response between the ad-libs and the lead vocal. Now they're doing different octaves. Harmonizing now. So they're kind of switching between like doubling notes in their own way, like the ad-libs. Then it does octave apart. Then they do harmony. So they're kind of going like this. Like, so they're doing like a unison line, and then they go like harmony. Then they go like octave higher, and they're kind of constantly flowing like this. And the background vocals, because they're singing the lead line, they're kind of taking the load there. Like they're doing the lead line and the harmonies. And then the ad-lib and the lead vocal have room to play with, so they can actually do this kind of stuff. And it's quite inventive what they've done in the finale. And that's really just to change things up, because you've already had the chorus twice at this point. So in this finale, they really start to play with that ad-lib and lead vocal call and response stuff. Call and response. So they're covering a lot of octaves there. They've got the lower level vocal, they've got the falsetto one that's doing its own thing, and they've got the vocals in the middle, the vocal stack with the harmonies doing the lead vocal melody of what it usually is, which is a very common thing in pop music. You notice a lot of the time, even in like the classics, you'll hear that in the finale, a lot of the time they let the chorus melody get sung by like the background vocals or the pack vocals, and then the lead vocal will go off and do like its ad-lib thing while that's happening. So it's just another way that you can play with your choruses. All up, I think that's everything I wanted to speak about with this track. It really shows you how to produce for a band, if they're a live band, and then how to actually integrate electronic elements and samples into that to make the track like a hybrid, and really make it sound modern sounding, the modern sound sonically is at any given time. So hope you enjoyed this one. Now, if you want to learn how to read songs like a book yourself, so actually learn how to analyze tracks, start to understand how the producers that you idolize think, and then actually understand the skill sets of how they do things, so that you can actually come to the DAW and get anything inside your mind onto the DAW with ease and have world-class decisions to every problem that you face, I highly recommend going to polymathproducer.com and booking a call with me. It's completely free, and we discuss your goals and all that and how ultimately I can help you achieve that by teaching you how to do this stuff. So if you want to see that, go to polymathproducer.com. And until next week, I'll see you then.